From unusual fossils to remarkable relics to new expressions of the imagination, we explore creation and the institutions that preserve our amazing artifacts. This is Special Collections, radio tours to all the cool places. Here's our host, Mark Burns.
The end of October rolls around, and the air begins to fill with the smell of freshly carved pumpkins, ready-to-be-unwrapped candy, and every kind of witch, ghoul, zombie, and goblin waiting to come out of the shadows. But in Altoona, Pennsylvania, you don't have to wait till October to experience that exciting Halloween air. I'm Mark Burns. Join us as we visit the whimsical world of the Castle Halloween Museum. But first,
you've seen my castle on the hill. You want to come inside? It is very beautiful inside, very dark, very cold, very nice. Please, please, come in. It is very nice. Please, let me show you the downstairs. It is my favorite part. Here, please, this way. No, no, there is no light down here. Come. Come a little closer, yes, yes.
Recognized as part of the inspiration for the home of the famous vampire Count Dracula from Bram Stoker's horror novel, Bran Castle in Bran, Romania is much more than just a spooky castle on a hill. With a rich history spanning hundreds of years, it is important to make the distinction between the actual facts of the important landmark and the fiction that has since been reflected upon it by the legends and stories of the area and beyond. Joining us today is Mate Simeon, the director of Bran Castle in Romania. So, Mate, welcome to Special Collections.
Thank you very much for inviting me.
I wanted to start with kind of a general question. It's about Romania. I think most Americans don't know too much about Romania, and we have a wide international audience. Can you tell us a little bit about your country, where it's located, and what it's famous for?
Well, first of all, Romania was, it's actually kind of like an island of Latin language. We are surrounded by the Carpathian Mountains, and we are the only country in the area which speaks Latin language. And we are surrounded by Slavic country, except Hungary. So this way you people will know better. In south, we have Bulgaria and Danube River. And then except Hungary, we also have Ukraine, Poland nearby, Slovakia, and they all speak Slavic, except Romania. And we have a border with the Black Sea, and nearby is Turkey. So we are in central Europe, obviously, because we are at the intersection of three big empires that they are, during the history, they were nearby. In south, we have the influence of the Turkish Empire, the Ottoman Empire, and then we have the Austro-Habsburg and later Austro-Hungarian Empire in west, and in east, it's the Russian Empire.
So it sounds like it's a real crossroads in many ways. I know the United States, for all its size, only has two neighbors, one to the north, one to the south. But you have, it sounds like, was it six or seven different countries right around you, as well as a major sea and river?
Yeah. What is interesting to know about Romania, that we have mountains, we have the sea, and we have the river and a flat area. So it's kind of like, I don't know, Kansas in America. Valahia is very flat like Kansas. Transylvania, it's a bit like Oregon. And we also have Moldova, which has three different types of mountains, hills, and flat area. So for that reason, you can go to the mountain, to the sea, and back to the river. Like you have Columbia River Gorge between Oregon and Washington State. Over here, we have Danube River. So from this point of view, from a geographic point of view, it's quite a spectacular country.
So we're talking today about Bran Castle, which you are associated with and helped to direct. And I know that that's at the border of two of these areas, right? A very mountainous area that's kind of on the edge of a flat area. And tell us why that area was strategic and why the castle was built there in the first place.
It's exactly like you said, at the border between two Romanian provinces, Transylvania and Wallachia. And the word Bran actually comes from the Slavic word Brana, which means gate. So in one side of the mountains, Transylvania, and in the other side, it's Wallachia. And the castle was built exactly at the entrance in the gate between the mountains. And from this point of view, from a strategical point of view, it was very important because it was exactly the border between the Austro-Hungarian Empire, back then Transylvania, and Wallachia, the Ottoman Empire. The castle was very, very important from a military point of view. It was the most important commercial road and the main military route between Transylvania and Wallachia. The local kings, like the kings from Hungary or Poland, or the local kings from Wallachia, it was very important for them because they all had a custom house nearby where they used to collect the tax. The tax was 3.3% from all the value of the goods. Of course, it was important for them because they used to collect the tax, and with the money that they collect, they used to pay the army, to support the army against the Turks or against the Austro-Hungarian Empire. Being at the border, it was very important for both of these big empires, the Ottoman Empire or the Austro-Hungarian Empire.
So when was the castle originally built then?
Well, the first document which talks about Bran Castle is 19 November 1377. This year, we will celebrate 640 years since the castle was built.
That's that's very, very old. When it was first built then, was it the same size and configuration that it is now, or was it originally smaller when it was first constructed?
Well, originally, when it was built and when it was constructed, at the beginning we had two towers and two floors, and right now we have four towers and four floors and 57 rooms. But during the time, they add some more. That because it became much more important, and obviously the army grew bigger, and the custom house and the merchants that they were coming, they were obviously increased the number, so you need a bigger garrison, but then you need a bigger castle. So yes, they were two towers, two floors. Right now we have four towers and four floors and 57 rooms.
Yeah, so it grew over time. The other thing that I think most people would immediately notice, in photos at least, or when they visited, was the fact that it's way high up in the air, isn't it? Is it a couple hundred feet above the valley floor?
Well, the rock, it's 60 meters, so I think it's 175 feet, only the rock. With the castle, it's 90 meters, 93 meters, so that means around a couple hundred feet. From the sea level, it's actually 890 feet.
From that height, it would be almost impossible to attack it. And those who were inside the castle would also have a view of anything coming in both directions, I assume, well before they arrived at the mouth of the valley.
So. Exactly. Now, because from the watchtower, they were able to see 360 degrees around. Is that the highest tower of the castle. So they cut the woods because in one part of the castle it's the mountain line area. So in order to be able to see the Turks coming, they cut the woods for 10 miles around, and they were able to see the enemy coming. And in the other side of the castle, there is a flat area as you come from the gate, from the Carpathian Mountains gate. They were able to see 25 miles far in the valley.
Yeah, so 10 miles on one side and 20 miles on the other. So there were no surprise attacks at all on this castle based on where it was located.
Only if they were sleeping or they were drinking too much.
Yeah,
I don't know.
That's right.
I guess.
Which is always a possibility with soldiers, I guess.
Oh, it's always, yes.
So who has the castle belonged to over time? I know it's changed hands several times, right?
Yes. Soon after the castle was built, the Hungarian king, Ludovic I of Anjou. But then they had an agreement with the local people from the city nearby in Transylvania. Brasov is the name, Kronstadt back then, or Corona, the city of the crown. Brasov, it's nearby, it's 20 miles away, and it's considered to be the most beautiful city in Romania. So it was owned by the city council of Brasov for a long period, till the end of the 19th century. And then the first private owner, after the First World War, we had the Great Union, and at that time Romania was a monarchy, and our queen did a great job at the peace conference in Paris. By the way, she negotiated over there with Woodrow Wilson and Clemenceau and all the others. And this castle, after 500 years as a military castle owned by the local people from Brasov or the local king, it became a private property, and Queen Mary was the first private owner in 1920, 1938. And then it was her daughter, Princess Ileana, which, by the way, in 1948, Romania was occupied by the Red Army, and the new communist government established by Stalin confiscated the castle. And that's the reason I said, by the way, Princess Ileana moved to America, first to Newton, Massachusetts, and then they established in Elwood City, Pennsylvania. And Princess Ileana family, they were all together in America. She died in 1991 in Youngstown, Ohio, at the border with Pennsylvania. That because nobody dies in Elwood City. It's a very happy city area, and everybody goes to die in Youngstown.
Especially royalty, I'm sure.
Yes, exactly. And in 1991, when she died, she never knew that castle will come back to her family, because in 2009, the castle was actually the owner of the castle, which is the son of Princess Ileana. It's Dominic Habsburg-Lothringen, but he's an American citizen. So Dracula Castle, which right now is number one tourist attraction in Romania, it's owned by an American. Is that because we love the Americans, I guess? No, he inherited the castle legally, but he was born in Romania.
Let me ask you this. I know one interesting phase in the history of the castle is when it was owned by, you know, communist authorities and part of the Soviet bloc. It appears to me, just from the background reading I've been able to do, that they actually treated the castle fairly well, right, and opened it up to the public.
Oh, yes. In 1957, the castle was open to the public. But back then, Dracula Castle or Bran Castle was not a very popular tourist attraction. There was a movie in the 30s, Black and White, the classic with Bela Lugosi, but then the Second World War came and Dracula was forgotten. But they took care of the castle, and it was actually up into the mountains, and Ceausescu later and some part of the Communist Party used to come in the summer up in the mountains for hunting, and it was used for this purpose because we had no tourists at the beginning. But then it became a tourist attraction after all the movies in Hollywood later with Francis Ford Coppola movie, Gary Oldman, Frank Langella, George Hamilton, Keanu Reeves, Anthony Hopkins. The story about Dracula explodes in the 90s, and we start to have thousands of tourists, which, let me tell you, at the very beginning was a big surprise for the local people because they never heard about Count Dracula. When the guys arrived here, they asked, they were like, who's Dracula? But when they saw a lot of money coming with the guys from England and Germany, and the very next day they came back and they said, oh, yes, come and visit. I remember my grandma had 2 marks over here at night.
So they adapted very quickly to the onslaught of tourists when Dracula started to become a popular movie and book and everyone started to talk about it. Tell us a bit about Dracula, if you would, where that myth comes from and how it gets associated with this castle.
Now, when it comes to Dracula, it's very complicated. It's easy when we talk about Frankenstein because Mary Shelley wrote the book and she created a new character. But yet people still go to visit Frankenstein Castle nearby Darmstadt in Germany because the book and the movie, that because there were lots of movies about Frankenstein, and they go over there. But when it comes to Dracula, not only that the legend exists and the myth, but the character exists. So Bram Stoker wrote the book, Dracula, and he said in his book that this Count Dracula hide into a castle in Transylvania. And this is where the confusion is coming. The king that exists, Vlad Dracula III Basarab, better known as Vlad the Impaler, he exists as a human, like me and you, but he died as a human In 400 years, there was no book like Dracula. They wrote about Vlad the Impaler, many, many other books and legends and stories, but historical books, not like Bram Stoker's story as a gothic novel. So 400 years, he was a local legend, like Ataturk in Turkey, or, I don't know, Rasputin in Russia, or Napoleon in France. But in 1897, Bram Stoker had an idea to write a book about a monster that goes from Transylvania to England, and he was struggling to find a name for his idea. His idea was to create a monster to scare the English people. So when Bram Stoker searched about this king of Wallachia, he discovered that he died in a mysterious way. His body disappeared. The coffin, when they looked into the coffin, the body was missing. So it came out a great gothic story. And because the body is missing, the coffin, I mean, we have the place where he was buried. It's a monastery near Bucharest. People can go and visit at the synagogue lake. It's a beautiful place. But if you go over there, it's an empty coffin. It's quite mysterious because if you ask the priest to let you go and look, they say, no, it's impossible. But everybody knows in Romania that the coffin is empty.
So out of everything that you just described, how much of that was local folklore already that had developed over 400 years, and how much was invented by Bram Stoker? Is it about 50-50?
A bit more close to reality than 50-50. I'd say it's 60 history, and 40% it's folklore that Bram Stoker uses, and he creates something else. Because in our legend, in our folklore, we still hope that Vlad will come back to save the country, because he did it once. He refused to pay the tribute to the Turks. He saved Romania. He raised the corruption. And that really, you know, it's a problem in Romania right now with the corruption. And of course, everybody wants to, because we want to solve this problem. So we believe that only Dracula will come and help us.
So let me take just a minute to identify ourselves. This is Special Collections on BYU Radio. We're speaking with Mate Simeon at Bran Castle, also known as Dracula's Castle, in the country of Romania. So it's interesting what you just said. There was a couple things that really struck me. One is the home run that Bram Stoker hit. That's a baseball metaphor. It's an American sport. But yeah, the goal that he scored, in football terms, I should say, with the name Dracula, it's just perfect. It sounds like evil, and you can kind of play with it. The other thing was, I think it's absolutely fascinating that all the way up to the present, the folklore of Dracula, including the additions by Bram Stoker, are used to fight corruption in the country today and to represent corruption as a negative thing, you know, with these kind of dark forces attached to it that needs to be avoided and needs to be rooted out, just like you would some kind of a monster. So the spirit of Dracula lives on in many different ways, it sounds like. Let me ask you this. When people come to the castle and take a tour, what do they get to see in the castle, and how much do you play up the Dracula association?
Well, when they come, first of all, they are different kind of people. Some people like spectacular and glamorous places, like beautiful palace. But when you come to see an old castle up on the rock with a creepy look and, you know, cozy, but in the same time, it looks like a military castle, this is what you can find over here. When you go around Europe, there is another castle in Slovakia which looks exactly the same and one in Austria. But this one, particularly because it's built up on the rock, it gives you a feeling since you go up, kind of like it's unreachable. The guy which built the castle, or the king that used this castle, definitely either was trying to hide over here or to stop people to get close to him. This is the feeling you get when you come close to the castle. And then when you come inside, actually, immediately since you come, you can get the feeling that it's very old, the smell inside. But then, because 500 years after the castle was built, the castle was entirely renovated, then you get a cozy feeling. The rooms are Queen Mary refurbished. We have electricity. She brought electricity, running water. But the walls are very thick. It reminds you it was an old military castle used by the local kings to stop the Turks. And then people, when they come, this is what they can see. Four floors, 57 rooms. The queen refurbished the castle, and then when Dominic got it back, he brought some new pieces from his personal collection and Princess Ileana collection, which, by the way, Princess Ileana inherited her collection from her mother, Queen Mary. It is a beautiful, cozy castle. Now, for a night tour, totally different. During the night, it's creepy, and we will have these Halloween night tours. So you can get different experience from this point of view.
So is Halloween a big deal in Romania like it is here in the United States?
Oh, yeah. In the last year, it became quite a big deal. Not only that, we have lots of people from outside Romania, like Australia, New Zealand, England, Spain, a lot of people from Spain, Italy, America, Canada. But the Romanian people are really, really adopt this holiday, and it became kind of like a Romanian custom to get dressed in different characters and come over here and have a party. Last year, our Halloween party was, I think, 2,000 people here.
Tell us also, that makes me think of this. We found, as we were doing some research, that there was an Airbnb contest recently, and the winner had the chance to sleep at Dracula's castle there, at Bran Castle. Can you tell us about that and how it worked out for the winners?
The Airbnb arranged for a couple to come and sleep overnight, and they arranged two coffins. But also we had a bedroom. Obviously, nobody would stay and sleep 8 hours in two coffins. They stayed for a while. The couple was from Canada, and in the last 65 or 70 years, nobody slept in the castle. So, of course, it was quite a huge event. Airbnb paid everything for this couple.
Oh, that's great.
From Canada.
And did they not last the entire night in the coffins because they were uncomfortable or because they were too creepy?
Yeah. Well, actually, everybody believed that they really slept in the castle the whole night. But a lot of people asked me about this. Obviously, no, they didn't sleep. They stayed only for the camera, like 5-10 minutes. And then they went to a bedroom, the king bedroom.
That wasn't quite as scary as the room with the coffins, I guess.
No. But it's not comfortable. I mean, if from our point of view, as the castle point of view, if they want to stay and sleep 8 hours in the coffin, it was no problem for us. But they were really coffins, like normal coffins, where you can sit on your back with your hands on your chest, and you cannot move around. As a normal people, for instance, I change my position like maybe 10 times during the night. But you cannot do it because we also cover them for the 5 minute show when they had.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah.
Oh, that would make it twice as scary to have the lid on the coffin down on top of you. Oh, my goodness. Unless you're ready to stay there for several thousand years, it would be a little bit harrowing, I think.
If you put some ice inside and you stay 7,000 years, But I remember the girl was quite courageous, but the boy, after a few seconds, he knocked in the coffin and he said, "Let me out, let me out."
I'm not dead yet.
Yeah, I'm not dead. Please, I don't want to die here.
Well, I have to say that is one of the most interesting, fun-sounding promotions for any museum I've ever heard of. Or any castle, I guess I should say. That's terrific. Let me ask you this. Is there one other thing about the castle that we haven't talked about that you would want listeners to know?
Besides the fact that the castle is the most popular tourist attraction in Romania, there is a book, 1,000 Things That You Should See Before You Die.
Oh, yeah, I've seen that, yeah.
And in America, you have lots of them. In Romania, we only have this one, like, I guess. Peru, Machu Picchu, each country has a number one. Taj Mahal in India, Eiffel Tower in Paris. But it holds the story and the legend of a real character, not a created character, like Harry Potter or Frankenstein or, I don't know, the Hobbit sitting right now in New Zealand. It is a real castle with a real character that he used the castle against his enemy. And when he collected and he killed all the thieves in the land. So all this, it's a castle, a real castle, which talks about connected with a real character. So that's the most important thing. I mean, people will not be disappointed, like when you go to Harry Potter castle. Hogwarts, 20 years ago, nobody knew about Hogwarts Castle or Rosalind Chapel in Scotland before the movie with Tom Hanks and the book Da Vinci Code. I mean, not people from Rosalind Chapel never heard about Rosalind Chapel. But when it comes to Dracula, Dracula, this castle was here in the time before he was born as a human. This is, I'm telling you this because a lot of people are confused when they come to Romania, because he was the king of Wallachia, Dracula, Vlad. He was born, though, in Transylvania, in Sighișoara. It's a different place, like Sacramento in California, and they have San Diego and San Francisco. Same over here. So it's a bit confusing. So a lot of people, when they come in Transylvania, when they come over here, they are confused. And I understand them. It's normal to be confused because he was the king of Wallachia, and there is a different palace, a different castle, the place where he used to live as the king. So that's the reason it's confusing. It's kind of like Arnold Schwarzenegger, if you heard about this guy. He was born in Austria, but he was the governor of California. But he's better known in the whole world as the Terminator, same with Dracula.
As we wrapped up our interview, Matei gave us a sample of how he works to bring a bit of fun into his tours of Dracula's castle.
Now, it's funny because people like to get scared. And then after they get scared, usually they relax and they laugh. But I like when I go with my group as the tour guide, I go close to the secret staircase. People are frightened already. And I turn my back, like I'm trying to go inside, but suddenly I turn back to them, and I hit the floor like this, but in the same time I scream to them like, "Dracula, castle with Dracula!" Everybody gets scared, and then they laugh.
That was Matei Simeon, the director of Bran Castle, which is also known as Dracula's Castle, in Bran, Romania. Next on Special Collections, we'll connect with Pamela E. Apkarian-Russell, the owner and curator of the Castle Halloween Museum in Altoona, Pennsylvania.
This is Special Collections, radio tours to all the cool places. Here's our host, Mark Burns.
I guess how much candy do you have?
What kind of candy?
Every single kind.
I have like 17.
Really?
Yeah.
Did you get Kit Kat?
Nah.
Trick-or-treat!
Aw, look how cute y'all are. What have we here? Let me see. We've got a zombie. Oh, I love that toilet paper. A witch. Oh, classic. Michael Jackson. Nice glove. Ladybug. How darling. And, I'm sorry, sweetie. What are you?
I'm Goku. He's a character from a really cool TV show called Dragon Ball Z. You've probably never heard of it.
Well, no, I haven't, but that's some hair you've got. Quite some hair.
Anyway, thanks for the candy, lady.
Of course. Happy Halloween, kids.
Bye.
Happy Halloween.
Thanks for the candy. Okay, bye.
October 31st is the special day when we can put candles in cut-up gourds, dress like somebody else, and ask strangers for candy. And in Altoona, Pennsylvania, the fun and franchise that has oozed out of this holiday has been preserved at the Castle Halloween Museum. Home to thousands of Halloween-related artifacts, the museum aims to help us maintain the spooky spirit throughout the year. So we're speaking today with Pamela E. Apkarian-Russell, the owner and curator of the Castle Halloween Museum. Pamela, welcome.
Thank you. It's lovely to be on.
So I have one question for you to begin, and that is, how did you start to collect so many different things having to do with Halloween? Were you a Halloween fanatic from age 3, or how did you start this whole thing?
No, actually, we lived way out in the country, so we really didn't get to do too much trick-or-treating at all. But, you know, being a New Englander by birth, Halloween was always a very big thing. And I think it starts with the autumn colors. There is nothing so magical as autumn colors on the trees. So I think you sort of like fall in love with the season. And then, Chris, I was always loved, you know, the paranormal and you know, grew up on books like Edgar Casey and Susie Smith and things like that. So Jean Dixon was very big at the time. So you read all of those things and you become very enamored to it. And then, Chris, Massachusetts, where I was born, the Salem Witch Trials, and I was always a history buff, so even as a little kid, so I really got into the Salem Witch Trials, and that sort of like started other things.
So when did you start to collect kind of seriously?
Well, Chris, there was really nothing around when I was a kid. Of course, the things that what we consider vintage today from the 40s and 50s and 60s were around, but we could never afford those things. times have changed. But I didn't start collecting until, you know, I was like, you know, in my late teens. And it was really with the books. I started a very big book, a collection on books on the paranormal and on the Salem Witch Trials. I don't think I found my first piece of real Halloween thing, a noisemaker on the secondhand market, until I was like about 20, 21.
Okay, so still fairly young. And the museum that you have, how did that begin or get organized in the first place?
I think it's because everybody wanted to come and look at what I had. And I was doing so much research because I've written a lot of books on Halloween and, you know, the Halloween collectibles and on Salem Witch collectibles. And people wanted to see it, but I had no place to show it because, A, I had so much. Every antique show, every flea market, anything that I could get to. I'm a professional antique dealer. I would be out there asking for it, looking for it. And this is something that was never at the shows back then. It was not considered anything but junk, far as they were concerned back then. You know, candy containers and toys and stuff. So, I mean, I've been in the business for like 46 years. Full time. So you can imagine that how the market has changed in those years. But when I was asking for it, people just laughed at me. They thought I was out of my mind.
And you get the last laugh because now a lot of it, I'm sure, is quite valuable and many, many people are looking for it. But
absolutely.
Yeah. How did you finally end up then in the really almost perfect building that you have for this kind of a museum in Altoona, Pennsylvania?
Well, we were looking for a place because we had opened up the museum in West Virginia for quite a few years, and then mine came in behind us and the frackers in front of us and the ground shakes, and it just became a nightmare. So we really knew we had to get out there, and a friend of ours found this place. And in retrospect, it certainly is not the perfect place because we need something at least 3 times the size.
Yeah,
we have so much that isn't on display. And I really believe if you're going to have eye candy, have eye candy, have it there so that everybody can see it. And it also makes it a lot easier for us to do research work, for me to work on my books, and for other people who are doing, whether it's photographic or doing research work, to be able to see what we have.
Yeah, and to have it all out all at one time in a big enough space, even though it would be better if it was 3 times as big, as you said. Somewhere on the website, you have a really interesting phrase. It says that you made the conscious decision to create not a haunted house, but a cosmos of fantasy Halloweens, past and present. What did you mean by that?
There are a million haunted houses out there in all different degrees. And I've never been really interested in blood and gore, and I think zombies are the most boring things that God ever created or didn't create. I'm not quite sure. But I just feel that I want the fantasy of Halloween. I want the Halloween as Robert Burns came out. You know, he did the first poem on it, was called Halloween, and then he did Tam O'Shanter. I want the fantasy. I want the harvest holiday. I want the little veggie people that run around in the forest. I want in the farms, and I want the colors, and I want the fantasy of being able to go and become anything or anybody you want. I don't go in for the blood and gore. I want the beauty of the holiday. I want the fun of it. I want to feel that I can walk around a corner and bump into one of the elves or one of the ants from Tolkien, or I can bump into a real wizard or a fairy or something that is not real. I want to be able to remove it from reality. Reality is very harsh, and I like to see the beauty of fantasy.
Oh, that's wonderful. And it's funny because I think most people have a different take on Halloween. They see it as what it's become, which is more blood and gore. And the fact that you're playing up the fantasy side, I think, would make your outlook, but also your museum, quite original in a lot of ways.
Oh, absolutely. But, you know, there are a lot of people who agree with me on the fantasy side. That's how it all starts off anyway. The blood and gore, my feeling is that if I was really into that, I'd go work in an ER, you know, and work with that type of thing. I'll go work in an ambulance or something like that. That's just not my thing.
Now, tell us about your trademarked name, the Halloween Queen. How did you acquire that, and how do you trademark a name? I didn't know that you could do that. No, I guess lots of people do that.
But. Yes, because I use it for the books I write. I write for the lectures I give, for the exhibits I do. It started off, I was doing a very posh antique show in Washington, D.C., and this man was set up beside us. And every year, Christmas time, I used to do a big display of all the holiday stuff. I would save it up for that show, whether it was Christmas and Easter and Halloween. And people used to flock in to get some of this early vintage stuff. And it was just really great. It was always, you know, with the Halloween part, it was always my duplicates. And he took umbrage to the fact that he had to set up beside the Halloween Queen and her junk. And so we just laughed about it. And somebody said, you know, that's really a great moment to take. And I said, you know, maybe I will. And then other people started, you know, using it in relation to me. So I said, well, I think I should register it and use it, you know, and that's what I have done. And it doesn't bother me that it was used in a derogatory way because he was the loser, not me.
So how big is the museum then? And how many items do you have inside?
You know, it's really difficult to say. I would say we have at least 35,000 pieces, you know, but then when my library, my research library is vast, and, you know, who knows what that encompasses. We have tried to break it down in certain different areas. You know, of course, we mix the vintage in with the folk art and the art, but we have separate rooms for the Harry Potter stuff and the Nightmare Before Christmas because we really always feel that really calls for a separate place because that's what younger people are going to really like.
And do you have, I read this somewhere, I think, an Andy Warhol print as well or painting?
We have the Andy Warhol Dracula. It's a signed numbered one. I think he did like 50 of them at one point. I'm not sure if that was that many, but he did do them up as many as 50 of any of that type of thing. And it's signed and numbered.
And he's from Pittsburgh, so I'm sure he'd be glad to have you, you know, as a holder of one of his paintings.
You know, I'm delighted to have it. You know, they recently, the ones he did of the witch was up for auction, but I couldn't even contemplate getting into it because of the money. But it's just really lovely to have, you know, one of his pieces here.
So let me ask you about a couple sections of the museum, if I can, and feel free to tell us about other parts that we don't mention. But first of all, the Memento Mori section of the museum. Tell us what a Memento Mori is and the examples of it that you have there.
In memoriam, Memento Mori is in memoriam, to be remembered. We sort of mix it with the Day of the Dead, and I do it for this reason. First of all, we have a tremendous amount of the hair wreaths, which I absolutely love because they are a form of folk art in themselves. Some of every single one of them is completely different, and there is a charm about them. Some of them are done with added things by the people who from the families themselves. Some of them have been sent out and been done. We have this humongous one, a Masonic funeral one, and it's the largest one we know of. And then there are small ones that people have done up as pictures. There is so much of a variety. But it's to remember the person. These start in Victorian days and earlier than that, actually. And the idea of it was to be able to keep these people with you. And if this is pre-photographs and this is pre-a lot of these things, you needed to keep them with you. It was the way to remember them. They also made jewelry, so it's not just the pictures themselves, it's the jewelry that they included. And then we tried to show the dour sadness of what Queen Victoria did, because when, you know, Albert dies, she becomes a miserable, horrible old lady and makes everybody else miserable around her.
Oh, for decades, yeah.
Oh, yeah. I mean, when 1901 comes and she passes away, it was like the whole world sighed in relief, you know, thank God we can get rid of this terrible mourning that's going on at all times. And then we put it beside the Day of the Dead, which they made some wonderful, wonderful fantasy pieces in the Day of the Dead. You know, the dancing, laughing skeletons and all of this wonderful stuff. You see the difference of how people looked at death. It's okay. It's a fact of life. It happens. But, you know, at least once a year we can call them back, celebrate with them, offer them food, offer them music, offer them our love. Tell them we remember them, we care about them. Not just the, as I said, the dour darkness of Victorian mourning.
So the Day of the Dead, you're talking about the Mexican holiday, right, primarily?
Well, Mexican and also South American, you know. It's not just Mexico. I mean, I have a few pieces from Guatemala and Venezuela and other places. So it's really much of South America as well.
This is Special Collections, Radio Tours to All the Cool Places on BYU Radio. We're talking with Pamela E. Apkarian-Russell, the owner and curator of the Castle Halloween Museum in Altoona, Pennsylvania. So tell us about your section on voodoo also.
Again, I love folk art. And the voodoo flags, of course, are all handmade. They're all of sequins. You know, I always tell people when they're taking a tour, there are two types of voodoo. There is voodoo of television in the movies, which people think is real and isn't. And then there's the voodoo of reality, which people think isn't real, which is. And it's a cross between Catholicism and the old African religion. And, you know, what we see on television seems to be what people think is reality, and it seldom is. In movies, that's supposed to be a form of fantasy. It's supposed to be not real, but people get very confused. But the flags are absolutely beautiful, some of them, I mean. And, like, it would depend on what you would put on your flag, depending on what was important to you. I mean, like, we have some wonderful ones with mermaids on them. Well, who would have mermaids? Probably a fisherman. And so, or somebody with this great big blue car on it. Well, maybe he drove a car for a living, or maybe that was his favorite car. And so they would be all very, very special to that particular person. Everyone would be very individual, but the artwork on them is absolutely beautiful. I think it's a form of, because it shows up so much in movies and TV, I think it's not only a form of folk art, but because of how it's made, but it's also a form of the paranormal or you know, semi-quasi-religious type of thing that we incorporate in, because it's peripheral of bringing your ancestors in and being able to speak with or talk with those who are not of the same makeup as us, like human beings.
So with something like voodoo flags, where do you get these? Have you been to Haiti to collect them, or do they just, for people who don't have a museum, sometimes it's just amazing how you get all these things. And voodoo flags, where did you pick those up or acquire those?
Most of them I've gotten from folk art auctions and from other collectors. Unfortunately, I've never been fortunate enough to get to Haiti because the art of Haiti is just absolutely beautiful. But a lot of that type of stuff also comes out of Louisiana. I don't know if that's because there are people down there that have collected a lot of it or used a lot of it. But I've been able to get pieces from down there as well. But usually folk art auctions and auctions is where I've been able to get most of my voodoo flags over the years.
So you must have your eyes open kind of all the time for things that are becoming available.
I'm very fortunate that when I started collecting, there wasn't anybody out there. There wasn't too many people out there. So a lot of the auctioneers know me around the country because I've been in the antique business for so long as well. And so when something comes up that they think I'm going to be interested in, they just contact me. Or if a collector has something that they are going to get rid of out of their collection or they're going to be selling their collection, a lot of times they contact me. So that really makes it a lot better for me.
Yeah, you know you've arrived when they come to you to tell you about what they have. So tell us about the moonshine jugs and another part of the museum.
Oh, the southern pottery. Of course, that's very, very big down south. Always has been. Starts with the African slaves. And we've never gotten into the really big-time money pieces because we certainly can't afford it. But things like, you know, jugs that were made by people like Dave the Slave and things like that, they're just beyond our being able to afford that type of thing. But they made these wonderful face jugs, very primitive. I've tried to sort of like almost specialize, though I have a lot of the men, with a lot of the women potters that I really love, like Vicki Miller and certainly Marie Rogers. Marie Rogers died a few years ago, and she was in her 80s. And still potting until, they say, just before she passed away, even though she was almost blind, totally blind. But there's a primitiveness, a beauty about them that is just absolutely wonderful. And they were used to begin with as votives on the grave, but then they became, you know, large and they were used as jugs. And they made them, a lot of people call them ugly, but we go for the ones that are not just ugly, but that have that, you know, like pumpkin or a witch or something type of a motif to them because it fits in with what we do. But with Marie Rogers, I have so much of her pieces that just are not really Halloween, but I could not live without them. But her, a lot of the face jugs that they used to put moonshine in. And of course, everybody knows moonshine is the devil's own drink. So you had to have something scarier than the devil himself to keep away, you know, the devil so he wouldn't steal your moonshine. It became very, very big for moonshine at one point. Just every one of them is so individual, so very different. It's an art all in itself.
So it sounds like the ones that are a little bit ugly are probably supposed to be ugly, right?
They're all ugly. Yes.
But in a purposeful yes. way, not ugly by mistake, but deliberate ugly.
Definitely.
Let me ask you about another part of the museum. That is the Easter Witches of Sweden, which I had never heard of before I saw your website.
Yes, it's really very charming, really, when you think about it, because when Europe was doing its burning years, Scandinavian countries really weren't. But in Sweden, the witches come at Easter time. They land on your roof, they make coffee, and they bring prosperity to your house. It means that you don't spill the beans, the milk doesn't go bad, the coffee doesn't, you know, taste terrible. You know, they bring that prosperity to the home. Then they fly off to this mythical mountain called Blackula. They make some more coffee, some stew, sing and dance, and go home to their homes and bring prosperity to their villages and towns. When the Swedish migration comes to this country, it becomes our kitchen witches. So all of these kitchen witches that we have in the homes today, it's basically the Easter witch from Sweden.
Oh, I didn't know that. I have seen kitchen witches before. Do you have those in the museum as well?
Oh, yes. We've got some of the old Drinkwater. Drinkwater was a wonderful pottery company that made some lovely ones. And we also had a friend in Sweden who got sent us over a whole bunch of stuff, which we really like. And it shows, you know, how things morph and change and are integrated into something. You know, nothing stands on its own, I keep on telling people, that something can start one way, and then as things are added to it, it changes. And I think Halloween, more than when you think about Burns and Halloween before our American Revolution, and bringing that, they bring over that seed of those poems, and they add it to the harvest holiday, and then they add the ghost stories. Well, ghost stories are from every country, so it wasn't just the Scots and the people from the Celtic lands. As each group came in, as the Hessians came over, as the Dutch came over, they all bring over their ghost stories. They're added in. All of the different cultures add something into it, and something grows, and it changes. And that's the fun part of it. That's the beauty of it.
Yeah, and as a researcher as well, and even as a museum curator, I know one thing you must be really trying consciously to do is tease out the origins of all of these different Halloween traditions.
Oh, absolutely. And it's not just the origins of the traditions. It's who picks them up and how they change and how they affect something. I love the Green Man motif from the cathedrals in England. And the Green Man is such an important element, and how it's become so big in the green movement in this country, and how it's become big in not only just, you know, florists and flower shops and stuff, but it's become almost a symbol of, you know, the green movement in this country, which I think is really very healthy. But he is what Charles Dickens uses as the ghost of Christmas present, and becomes, you know, the Green Man is the ghost of Christmas present, who morphs in and becomes really Father Christmas.
Oh, wow, that's interesting. And just clarify for all our listeners, what is the Green Man, or who is the Green Man that you're talking about?
The Green Man shows up in different ways all over. He has many persona, and you could even say Jack Frost, a form of him. But he was the figure in early times that would keep life alive during the winter. Winter comes, everything dies. You have to have an element, a supernatural element, that would keep things alive. And that's why things like the mistletoe and the fir trees and the acorns and root crops that would be put underground and saved, these are the things that would make it important to him, because they were not only symbols of him, but he was keeping that alive. Because if he didn't do that, there would be no spring for us. We would not continue on. People back in those days, but if the Green Man wasn't there, there would be no spring. They would all die during the winter because they would not have food. They would not be able to live, and that would be the end of the world.
And then the Green Man allows rebirth and almost kind of a resurrection to take place in
Absolutely.
The spring. Yeah. So what is the one thing or the most important thing that you would hope someone would get as they come to the Castle Halloween Museum in Altoona, Pennsylvania?
I think the joy of the fantasy. I mean, I want them to be with, you know, because social history tour I give them. So it's not just the eye candy. But I want them to get the joy of the holiday, not the blood and gore section. I want them to see the joy of the holiday and how everything interconnects, and be able to walk out of here and enjoy it even more, and be able to incorporate some of those things into their lives.
Well, I can say, without having been there yet, I can just feel the joy in your museum and in everything that you do and collect and present to the public. So thank you, Pamela, for being with us today. Remind us again of the name of your museum and where it's located.
It's Castle Halloween Museum, and we're located in Altoona, Pennsylvania.
Which is about an hour from Pittsburgh or so?
Yeah, about that.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
Okay.
Right, not that far from State College.
Yeah, where Penn State is. Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, thank you for your time today. We appreciate it.
Oh, thank you. I really enjoyed it. I was charmed.
Okay. And charmed is a good thing, I know, in your vocabulary. So I'm glad that we were able to attend.
I never thought of that.
Okay. Thanks again. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
This is Special Collections, radio tours to all the cool places. This episode was produced by Abby Nielsen. The recording engineer was Alex Hayden. We received extra production assistance from Sage Smiley and Andy McQuinn. I'm Mark Burns. You may send us feedback or listen to archived episodes of our show by visiting byuradio.org/specialcollections. Special Collections is a production of BYU Radio. Thanks for listening.